So I'm Patty Anders, and I'm thrilled to take this opportunity to introduce our LRA president, Professor David Yeadon. David hails from the University of Arizona, where he's a professor of language, reading, and culture in the Department of Teaching, Learning, and Sociocultural Studies in the College of Education. He's also an affiliate faculty in the College of Humanities and the Interdisciplinary University of Arizona PhD program in Second Language Acquisition and Teaching, which we call SLAT. In addition, I mean, being president of LRA and being full load on the faculty isn't quite enough, and so he is the co-director of the Research Group on Child Development, Research and Policy, and the co-director of the iMovement Miscue Analysis Laboratory in the College of Education. All of us here from the U of A and those who couldn't come and are back at Tucson, the town with the other university, are honored to call him our colleague and our friend. We were pleased as a faculty to woo Dr. Yeadon from the University of Southern California a few years ago. Previously, his academic appointments included the University of Oklahoma, Emory University, University of Houston, and he was also spent some time as a visiting professor and scholar at Boston University. David started his career as a high school English teacher. And although he loved teaching, he began to wonder about that mystery called reading. His investigations at the University of Oklahoma led him to write a dissertation in 1982 titled A Multivariate Analysis of First Graders' Print Awareness as Related to Reading Achievement, Intelligence, and Gender. This investigation opened doors for a legacy of scholarship, some of which we'll hear about today. His legacy focuses on investigations of developmental issues in early childhood education, the acquisition of literacy and biliteracy in young children, family literacy, theories of reading disability, microgenetic and developmental research design, and the application of complex adaptive systems theory to growth in reading and writing. He has published in journal articles and book chapters. Some of those book chapters are archival, state of the field, integrative reviews, such as in the Handbook of Research Methods in Early Childhood Education, Handbook of Reading Research, Volume 3, Handbook of Research in the Teaching of the English Language Arts, and Handbook of Research on the Education of Young Children. Over the past four decades, and in addition to his multiple publications, he has presented his work at the major conferences most of us attend. But in addition, he has presented at the Jean Piaget Society, the National Association for the Education of Young Children, the Child Welfare League of America, and the National Council for Research in Language and Literacy. This legacy of scholarship and inquiry has prepared him for the presentation we are about to hear, Chasing Shadows: Why There Cannot Be a Simple Science of Literacy. If you're on LRA listserv, you have received messages from David this past year, sending shout-outs to us all about misconceptions, narrowly focused research, and misguided policies influencing our field. David is hoping that this conference will be a place to make these topics central to our conversations. I can think of no better way for him to begin those conversations than for him to share his vast knowledge and thoughtful perspectives. David?
Thank you, Patty. There are big shoes to fill at Arizona because Patty was president and also my colleague Kathy Short was president of NCTE. So they kind of go, well, you know, what are you going to do? You know? I came into the field of education from the humanities after a stint in Southeast Asia, followed by a wonderful experience in community college, where I decided that there would be nothing better in life and becoming a Russian literature professor. However, during a graduate program in English, I was perplexed at why some lewd stories in the Canterbury Tales were now a part of the English canon. Therefore, I decided to pursue a PhD in Chaucer studies. My introduction to research and thinking about the context of reading and writing early on was through literary criticism and the writings of cultural critics, such as Wolfgang Iser, Gayatri Spivak, Edward Said, Franz Fanon, James Baldwin, Stanley Fish, and some early Louise Rosenblatt. I was also greatly influenced by writers addressing current political and social issues as Regis Debois, Che Guevara, C.L.R. James, and Thomas Merton, whose essay War and the Crisis of Language, relating to the discourses surrounding the Vietnam War, is still one of the most illuminative treatises I've read on what Merchant termed denatured language, language twisted back on itself, obtuse, full of nonsense, thwarting productive dialogue, but ultimately, unfortunately, also fomenting violence, the kind favored even today by many politicians, journalists, pundits, and would-be kings. And it was through these writers and orators that I came to realize that literacy, the term of today, was and still is the purview of many fields outside of education, and in subsequent study invites many different perspectives. For example, Edward Said, the late Palestinian literary theorist and cultural critic, makes a compelling case in his book Culture and Imperialism that such literary and musical masterpieces of the 19th century as Conrad's Heart of Darkness, Austin's Mansfield's Park, and Giuseppe Verdi's opera Aida were key cultural supports to the promotion of racism and the colonizing interests of Belgium, Britain, and France. And the American historians Richard Slotkin and Patricia Limerick have both written graphically about the influence of early tabloid journalism, short sensational stories of Western heroes, and pamphlets which fired the imaginations of profiteers and settlers to move across the West, bringing disease, boarding schools, and accompanied by pillaging and murdering over 90% of the Native American population who had occupied the land for tens of thousands of years. I also discovered that scholars in disciplines like the classics have written extensively about reading practices in journals that we all read, Antiquity, Speculum, the Sumerian mythology, and the Classical Weekly. Perhaps many of you know of the illuminating insight into Homer's Iliad and Odyssey as a production of oral poetry, not written, with modern day examples in the complex oral narrations of early 20th century poets in Eastern Europe, as well as storytellers in most traditional societies, including the songs of slaves and rural preachers in the American South. And then we have the story recorded in the New Testament of how Philip heard the Ethiopian eunuch reading the prophet Isaiah aloud in his chariot and asked, "Do you understand what you're reading?" To which the eunuch replied, "How can I unless some man guide me?" Classical scholars understand this to be evidence that oral, not silent reading, was the practice for literate people in the first century AD, even in public. One of the most remarkable pieces about the invention of books identified by classical scholars as Socrates' story recorded by Plato and Phaedrus in 360 BC of a conversation between the god Thuth and King Thamus regarding the benefits of written language, to which King Thamus replied, "Oh, most ingenious Thuth, The parent or inventor of an art is not always the best judge of the utility or inutility of his own inventions to the users of them. This discovery of yours will create forgetfulness in the learner's souls because they will not use their memories. They will trust to the external written characters and not remember of themselves. Socrates goes on to say that writing Phaedrus has a strange quality and is very like painting, for the creatures of painting stand like living beings. But if one asks them a question, they preserve a solemn silence. And so it is with written words. You might think they spoke as if they had intelligence, but if you question them, wishing to know about their sayings, they always say only one and the same thing. Finally, there is also the perennial debate on the origins of written systems, whether they emerge from the indexing of commercial exchanges of goods and services or directly from the processes of communication itself. And emanating initially within the field of sociology, there's also been an extensive and ongoing debate, particularly since the publication of Goody and Watt's controversial piece, The Consequences of Literacy, on the arguable premise of whether populations with alphabets, in particular, have a different way of thinking, a more analytic rationality about the world than those with other scripts or people who have not to learn to read in any language. A further example from anthropology is found in Claude Lévi-Strauss' classic Triste Tropique, The Sad Tropics, who made the startling claim from his observation of the reaction to written language by members of some Brazilian populations that the only phenomena with which writing has been concomitant is the creation of cities and empires. That is, the integration of large numbers of individuals into a political system and their grading into classes or castes. Such, at any rate, is the typical pattern of development to be observed from Egypt to China. At the time when writing first emerged, it seems to have favored the exploitation of human beings rather than their enlightenment. My hypothesis, if correct, would oblige us to recognize the fact that the primary function of written communication is to facilitate slavery. The use of writing for disinterested purposes as a source of intellectual and aesthetic pleasure is a secondary result. And more often than not, it may be even turned into a means of strengthening and justifying or concealing the other, as tribal chieftains understood that by mimicking facility with such a tool of the white man came additional authority and power. Though these readings were quite stimulating and eye-opening, early on I decided that such heady topics should be left to better minds, and I was intent on my path to become a Chaucer scholar. My specific motivation for this choice came from listening to an interview with a director of the Chaucer Center at the University of Oklahoma, who said in response to an interviewer's question about how he spent his time, said, "I travel around the world, identifying and collecting the best pieces on Chaucer where I can find them. Then I return, analyze them, and if I think necessary, I teach a graduate course on my findings." Well, I decided that such a career was worth pursuing. And you might find it amusing that I gave such an answer to a colleague on a job interview some years ago, who looked very bemused but was gracious enough just to smile. However, by a chance visit to the College of Education at the University of Oklahoma, which was next door to the Humanities Building on campus, during my master's degree in English, I had been tutoring in a TESOL lab at a community college in San Luis Obispo, and observed some of the difficulties that speakers of languages other than English had with learning to read English, even those literate in their heritage language and a few others as well. So I wandered into the College of Education one day and asked a staff person in the dean's office if reading was a subject that was taught in the School of Ed. After a look of wonder as if I had pointed ears, they pointed me down the hall to a professor's office who was teaching a course in reading that summer. That professor, Dick Williams, a former student of Paul Berg, who is president of this organization from 1967 to 1968, suggested I take his course on the psychology of reading that summer to see if the subject resonated further with me. And for some unknown reason, the lumbering, dense, dry, sobering academies of Eleanor Gibson and Harry Levin's classic text, The Psychology of Reading, seem more compelling and relevant to the real world of literacy than the perennial and acerbic debates on the literary quality of the bawdy Miller's tale. One particular statement in Gibson 11 struck me then and today as being particularly relevant. In a section entitled, "What is Reading?", they write, "The first guiding principle for our research is that there's more than one process of reading. And if this is true, there's likely to be more than a single efficient way of giving instruction in the process. Consider the range of skill from a child reading a picture book to a mature reader extracting information from highly specialized texts in mathematics, logic, physics, or even Chaucer, I might add. Reading is not simply the decoding of written symbols to sound. Advocates of ultra-simple phonetic writing systems like Pitman shorthand, for instance, often try to give the public this impression. But fortunately, no one has been fooled so far, for very long at least. Literacy does not consist of being able to give a name or a sound upon the presentation of a written character. Neither is it a passive acquisition of an image somewhere in the head that a written word can then be matched to. Reading is an active process, self-directed by the reader in many ways and for many purposes." So after that summer, I was hooked. I changed my academic focus from Chaucer to reading education, withdrew from the English program, and reapplied for a PhD in the reading department, a decision which has sent me on a circuitous journey through 5 different universities, 3 public and 2 private, and which finds me at this very moment standing in front of you, colleagues, friends unlooked for, collaborators, and fellow literacy conspirators happily met over the last 40 years. Unfortunately, however, much to my chagrin, and I'm sure it would have been to Gibson 11 as well, a substantial number of legislators, in particular across the U.S., have been fooled into thinking that reading is the mere association of sound with symbol. And the result has been an overreach of legislative policies and laws passed in the name of the science of reading, which have directly impacted teacher education programs in at least 30 states. For example, here in Arizona, there's a new dyslexia screening test for kindergarten and first grade mandated by fall of 2022. 2 new required university courses covering the identification of dyslexia and the 5 pillars of reading, a la NCLB, to be in place by fall of 2023, and a new reading endorsement with a phonics focus and high-stakes assessment, which must be completed within 3 years of initial certification, otherwise the credential is revoked. This strident conservatism sweeping educational practice, also manifested in bans of discussion of critical race theory, gender identity, ethnic racial issues, and the history of slavery, perniciously euphemized in some states as involuntary relocation, has had an insidious and chilling effect on what teachers and students can discuss and read in our nation's classrooms. All the more disheartening is the squelching or outright ignoring of the research represented by LRA scholars and researchers, as reflected in the critiques of the science of reading research by most of the 50 articles in the recent 2 special editions of the Reading Research Quarterly, as well as a LRA commission comprehensive review by Peter Johnson and Donna Scanlon of the deep difficulties of determining the nature of and developing definitive criteria for diagnosing dyslexia itself, even if such a phenomena truly exists. Indeed, what is represented as research-based practice by science of reading advocates is directly opposed to what a majority of literacy scholars and professionals all over the globe have realized, that learning to read is far beyond just a cognitive function, but is deeply embedded in the racial, cultural, historical, socioeconomic, and gendered identities of language and literacy users. Unfortunately, this more sophisticated understanding of literacy development has been subverted, at least in the US, by a one-size-fits-all, oversimplified, retrograde definition of literacy, the predictable outcome, I believe, of adopting a simple view of reading. Thus, the rhetoric of the reading wars has now become more than just an armchair academic debate of the majority of the states, but is now encoded in the very laws and House bills and legislative policies of the majority of the states. Policies which are in turn being powered by staggering sums of money, such as the $90 million investment of Fulton County, Georgia, in a revamp of the failed NCLB initiative of two decades ago. Since, according to the wisdom of some district officials, some college programs don't sufficiently prepare future teachers to teach reading. Tennessee plans to spend $100 million on their Reading 360, a program that stresses the development of strong phonics-based reading skills, and the governor of Indiana is enthusiastically directing $111 million into programs stressing the science of reading in schools. Think of what else that money could do. Despite years of research evidence demonstrating the utter failure of these types of top-down educational reforms, summarized concisely by Anthony Bryke and colleagues in their book, Learning to Improve, How America's Schools Could Get Better at Getting Better, programs such as the one in Georgia, Arizona, Tennessee, and Indiana are being foisted upon school districts and university teacher training programs where nearly all of us work. Thus, we are required to spend time in questionable course development since legislators, public officials, journalists, and parents have become the self-appointed literacy experts. Attempting to determine both university curriculum and literacy, and even what topics literacy researchers and teachers can address in classroom settings, and what books can be read without surveillance by literacy vigilantes and the threat of lawsuits. How portions of our disciplinary field have gotten commandeered by such narrow special interests is a story worth researching and understanding. But in the meantime, what can be done in the present circumstances? What messaging needs to be shared throughout the literacy field with its diverse stakeholders that provokes serious reflection on the dangers of simple notions of learning or simple models of reading? Since the recent flare-up of the reading wars has one side assuming the mantle of science, it's important to point out that they're not the only claimants to this description. I would like to turn this conversation now to a discussion of developmental science, a branch of psychology with deep roots in the child study movement around the turn of the 20th century, and whose definitive scholarly voice has been consistently represented by subsequent volumes of the Handbook of Child Psychology, with its most recent edition entitled The Handbook of Child Psychology and Developmental Science. Paul Vygotsky himself passed long before the first volume was published in 1946. His perspectives on child development and learning literacy are well represented nonetheless. Vygotsky's essay on the prehistory of written language highlights several aspects of children's early writing development, which can also be considered fundamental to developmental science principles. He writes, "The history of the development of written language of the child presents great difficulties for research. To the extent that this can be judged by extant materials, the development of written language does not proceed along a single line, preserving a continuity of forms. The history of the development of written language contains the most unexpected metamorphoses. We frequently encounter characteristics of sporadic changes or breaks in the line of development. The line of development of written language in the child sometimes stops almost completely, and then suddenly, as if out of nowhere, from outside, a new line begins, and at first glance, it seems that between the broken off past and the beginning new, there's absolutely no continuous connection. But only a naive representation of development as a purely evolutionary process accomplished exclusively by gradual accumulation of separate small changes can conceal from our eyes the true essence of the processes that are occurring. Only someone who is inclined to imagine that all the processes of development are processes of germination will deny that the history of written language in the child is fully entitled to be represented by a single line of development, regardless of the breaks, dying off, and metamorphoses." From Vygotsky's statement, as well as from other findings within the literature of developmental science, the following principles can be identified. Namely, that normal growth is characterized by spurts, plateaus, and regressions rather than gradual growth. In other words, development typically is not smoothly uniform and cumulative, but asynchronous and nonlinear. As Thalen and colleagues have pointed out in their studies of the development of infants' early motor systems, even related subsystems involved in babies' early kicking, walking, and reaching behavior do not develop at the same pace. Each subsystem seems to have its own title for development, and the ongoing coordination between all of the subsystems is dynamically driven both by internal as well as the environmental factors. Second, increased variation often occurs after long periods of stability. This characteristic of development of many species is one of the fulcrum points of the theory of punctuated equilibrium, developed by the late paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould and his colleague Niall Eldridge as a modification of evolutionary theory. However, similar trends in the history of scientific thought have been noted by Piaget and Garcia in their book, Psychogenesis and the History of Science. What seems to be a phenotypic discontinuity in development is often reflective of the deeper continuity of the developmental trajectory. Or rather, what seems to be an absence at times of visible development in an area does not imply the non-existence of the skill or ability in question. The latter may simply be obeying a deeper law of development in which some other level of related organization is taking place prior to a more rapid mature development. And finally, wide variation within any level of development at any point is the rule rather than the exception. For example, Robert Siegler has persuasively shown that even when elementary children know a more sophisticated method for calculating mathematical sums, they will still employ lower level processes, such as counting on their fingers or orally counting all the numbers in an equation, at least as often as the more advanced method. Similarly, Fisher and Yan have shown in an analysis of Darwin's journals written while aboard the Beagle that Darwin simultaneously held many beliefs about the processes of evolution, both prior to and during his writing of The Origin of the Species. It appears then that both children and adults at any level of development have at their command a range of abilities which they employ sometimes economically and sometimes not to solve a variety of problems. What doesn't seem to be the case under any circumstances is that development involves the simple acquisition of a more advanced behavior or level of knowledge which then automatically becomes the normative way of operating. Rather, children and adults only slowly abandon old strategies which do not serve them well in the process of experimenting with newer strategy. Siegler has described this simultaneous orchestration of ability in his description of overlapping waves theory, where at any one time, children have several strategies at hand for which they draw in devising solutions for a variety of numerical and literacy tasks. Another statement by Vygotsky, which expresses the complexity involved in child development. But a positive picture of child development is possibly only if we radically change our representation of child development and take into account that it is a complex dialectical process that is characterized by complex periodicity, disproportion in the development of separate functions, metamorphoses or qualitative transformation of certain forms into others, a complex merging of the process of evolution and involution, a complex crossing of external and internal factors, a complex process of overcoming difficulties and adapting. Vygotsky used a geological metaphor to describe the above process. Just as the strata of the Earth is compressed, fractured, and riven with heat, pressure, and water, and the untidy accumulation of extinct life forms, so are the influences of development commingled, merged, piled up, and transformed. Thus, anyone who has worked closely with young children can appreciate Vygotsky's comments, particularly regarding the discontinuities, breaks, dying off, commingling, and metamorphoses of which he speaks regarding children's growth toward the mastery of written language. Even for researchers who have spent a majority of their time studying early reading and writing, a writing sample like the one produced by 5-year-old Anthony, an emergent Spanish-English bilingual, still provokes wonder and amazement at how a few graphic symbols can be arranged in such a dazzling display of directional exploration, combinatorial creativity, topological range, to represent both words and names, including his own. How many of you have those in your portfolio? But what types of literacy models are there currently which can explain in any systematic way the range of writing performances by young emergent bilinguals like Anthony with the obvious visual discontinuities and departures from the conventional standard? What types of models, metaphorical, statistical, computational, or otherwise, does the field have which can provide an explanation, for example, for how each graphic string represented in the sample shown is illustrative of an important feature of a unitary developmental trajectory? Or how do all of the graphic strings together speak to the typical or perhaps atypical trajectory being built at this moment in time? For reasons which will be discussed shortly, the type of model needed to illuminate developmental growth is not what is pictured below, despite that model's popularity as a model of literacy development. Perhaps some of you recognize this as coming from Whitehurst and Lonergan's chapter in the Handbook of Early Literacy Research. This type of model is representative of a family of models illustrative of a simple model of reading based upon the equation decoding plus language comprehension equals reading comprehension. Nonetheless, Paul Van Geert has also described such a model as retrospective. In other words, one that looks at the developmental processes from the perspective of a static end state and views all preceding states in light of this end state. In addition, Paris has pointed out, related to the modeling of early literacy skills, that researchers seldom take into consideration either the different developmental timescales of the variables which are measured or the fact that strong correlations depend only upon the partial development of ability, given that only partial development ensures statistical variation. One interpretation which can be drawn from Paris's observations is that constrained skills, as he calls them, or those abilities which seem to develop faster earlier, such as name writing, fall out of the model quickly, since most name writing scoring systems that index figural aspects only reach ceiling scores very rapidly, as most children learn to write their names prior to kindergarten in many cases. On the other hand, elementary outside-in knowledge, such as language development, vocabulary knowledge, conceptual and domain knowledge, which are learned across the lifespan, are harder to measure and drop out of the model later, either because of wide variation within the groups being measured or minimum variation due to test difficulty. But whether or not the variables measured statistically or fall out early or late, we are faced with a decision, as Paris reminds us, of interpreting the findings of developmental discontinuity, at least according to a simple model of reading, which relies on the lack of path coefficients in the model above, as supporting the following: that elementary outside-in knowledge, such as vocabulary or conceptual growth, doesn't correlate with reading in grades 1 or 2. That a large vocabulary in preschool or kindergarten doesn't necessarily help a first or second grader in learning to read. And that learning how to write one's name completely captures what it means to be an early writer. Thus, we must interpret these discontinuities as either being theoretically robust, according to the model, or on the other hand, as artifacts of factors related to both statistical conclusion validity of the measures used and of inadequate theorizing of the reading-writing acquisition processes. Treating the various aspects of literacy growth as developmentally isomorphic over time, which clearly they are not. Thus, there are at least two reasons to be highly skeptical of retrospective accounts of literacy development. First, according to Siegler, knowledge states are easier to describe than change processes, and that prolonged emphasis on documenting static states results in a distorted description of development, one in which children appear to spend far more time being than becoming. While retrospective or static state models may be important for sketching out possible relationships between constructs or variables, they do not actually measure change processes themselves, but rather static states of knowledge separated by arbitrary time periods. And as Vygotsky pointed out, it is only when becoming is studied from a historical perspective that the richness of development shows itself. He writes again, "To study something historically means to study it in motion. Precisely, this is the basic requirement of the dialectical method. To encompass and research the process of development of something in all its phases and changes, from the moment of its appearance to its death, means to reveal its nature, to know its essence, for only in movement does a body exhibit what it is." And some of you might recognize the sketch as one from Da Vinci. Secondly, according to Vygotsky and other developmentalists, knowledge and abilities which develop first do not simply fade away, but rather are incorporated into the fabric of more advanced growth and undergo change themselves on the trailing edge of growth, as it were, even as newer advanced concepts are added to the leading edge. Thus, as Vygotny has noted again, the new higher concepts in turn transform the meaning of the lower. The adolescent who has mastered algebraic concepts has gained an advantage from which he sees the concepts of arithmetic in a broader perspective. Therefore, higher order concepts illuminate and bring a broadened perspective to formerly held understandings, thus effectively transforming the entire learning and developmental system throughout, making it even more efficient, or in Piaget's words, a dynamic system always advancing and seeking and optimizing equilibration. And I would submit that as a child embarks upon the journey of becoming a literacy learner and a user of such symbols as we associate with that learning, that journey which continues over decades, not ending at third grade, as some state initiatives promote, but what is learned along the way does not become less important after its initial appearance, but rather undergoes continual reorganization within the learner's socio-emotional and cognitive networks in ways that enrich the whole learning system, making the child, adolescent, and adult even more efficient in capturing, acquiring more complex forms of knowledge. In other words, nothing is wasted, nothing is lost. I want to turn now to some specific examples of children writing their names, as well as other words, to illustrate the range of variation in understanding that children exhibit during such tasks, variation which is difficult, if not impossible, in a retrospective or simple model of reading. Depicted in the next few writing samples are several 4 to 5 year old Spanish-speaking children's writing performances across 11 tasks as they wrote their name, their mother's and father's name, several words such as mama, papa, baby, bear, toad, map, duck, and a sentence, my little girl sits in the sun. In Spanish they were writing. After each word was written, the child was asked to read it back, pointing with their finger, and in the case of the child's name, the first and last few letters were covered, and the child was asked to read what symbols were uncovered. The following are just a few examples of a corpus of 500 or so writing samples, which were collected over 2 years in a dissertation study by Joan Tartabono, funded by the Center for the Improvement of Early Reading Achievement. Note the differences, particularly between how children write their names and other words. As can be seen in these writing samples, children wrote using mostly a combination of uppercase letters and letter-like symbols, having a range of 3 to 11 symbols per word, which they arranged in different combinations and when writing different words. While some were more particular about writing words in a column, others wrote simply because there was space to write, with some children taking as many as 3 pages to record all the words. Despite the variation in how children chose to represent each one of these words, one of the more obvious features of the samples is that the child's name is the one word which is more conventionally written, or nearly so. And indeed, these samples illustrate, as many have pointed out over the years, the importance of the child's name in the beginning repertoire of what they feel they can write, at least in a situation where they are requested to write. However, in the samples illustrated, only Andres, according to all that we could detect from the testing situation, understood that the symbols being written in his name and some other words were second order. In other words, the letters represented some linguistic segments of the name or word as it was spoken. In all other cases, covering up portions of the child's name resulted in the child either not being able to recognize it or changing the form to another name with which they were familiar. Here is an example of each. Andres appears to know his name at the phonemic level. Jason substitutes other names.
Andres. ¿Qué dice? Andres. Ahora voy a cubrir parte. Ahora qué dice? Voy a cubrir esto. Ahora qué dice? ¿Esto dice Andres? No, ¿por qué? ¿Por qué dice Jeff? ¿Pero no dice Jason? ¿No dice su nombre?
For a majority of the children, the name was treated as a logo of sorts. In other words, a graphic which needed to be taken as a whole in order to be meaningful. Or in Vygotsky's terms, a first-order symbol, referring directly to their identity as a person. It is also an example of what Luria had described as illustrative of the glass window theory, indicating that children and adults too, in some cases, look through the forms of language directly to the meaning. In addition, we discover that while Andres understood that his name could be sounded out phonemically, this understanding did not extend to his mother's name or father's name, which were understood as intact graphic strings, as was the word oso, which he had been able to write conventionally several months earlier. Further, while he demonstrated a clear understanding of what Ferrero and Teborowski termed the syllabic principle, that most of the two-syllable words he was asked to write needed one symbol per syllable, that any individual symbol might represent a variety of sound units. Here is an example of Andres writing papá and nene, which is baby.
Papá. Mm-hmm. Here we
Love doing research in a preschool, right? You know, lots of things going on. In addition, he also wrote this entire sentence, my little girl sits in the sun, with two symbols as well, a P and an O, segmenting the sentence into larger clausal units, as well as changing the meaning of the sentence to something more relevant to him. My mother points at the sun.
Ahora vas a escribir, mi nena toma sol. Apunta con el dedo, léelo.
Mi mami punta sol.
¿Otra vez?
Mi mami punta sol.
¿Qué quiere decir eso?
Que mi mamá se punta el sol.
When they start folding the paper, you know they're done, right? Yeah. From what we could tell from this assessment and others we did in the classroom, Andres represented nearly the entire range of the five levels which Ferrero and Teborowski have described, from a very global syncretism to understanding the syllabic principle and even to demonstrating phonemic awareness, all in the span of the 10 minutes it took to produce the writing sample. The point I want to underscore here is that Andres' range of understanding the structure and symbolic aspects of the written system cannot be adequately determined by only look at the figural representation of his name. In fact, Andres would actually be scored lower using some of the more common assessments of name writing, such as the phonological awareness literacy screening scoring system, because of the two-letter reversals, even though none of the other children who wrote their names conventionally could segment them into linguistic units. Thus, name writing in and of itself is not completely informative of what a child is learning about written language, as are other types of writing tasks the child might attempt. What can be seen from the writing samples is that children's early writing performances are highly varied between children as well as with any one child's specific performance. A child's accomplishment of a series of writing tasks, such as the one comprising the research protocol, is not seamless, but interspersed with interruptions of various sorts, hesitations, perplexities, as well as uncertainties about how some words are to be written. If these analyses of very young children's writing are limited to only what we see in their names, then we've hardly scratched the surface in understanding their developmental trajectory before becoming facile with the written system. Notwithstanding the tremendous accomplishment of writing one's name at 3 or 4 years of age, most of the intellectual effort which is invisible in the brief moments of the act. At this period in a child's growth, it is a situational performance, requiring knowledge which may or may not extend to the writing of other names or words even a few seconds later. Therefore, name writing must be considered within a larger context of writing tasks and purposes within the network of a child's wider understanding of the use of written symbols before any display can be usefully interpreted. While methodologically it's important to do more sophisticated quantitative and qualitative research, it's perhaps more important for those of us studying the trajectory of literacy growth over time to have a more nuanced and powerful theory to explain how human beings develop. So then, what types of models and developmental principles are suggestive in explaining complex patterns of behavior, such as we see in young children's learning how to write? For some physicists, mathematicians, and chemists at the Institute of Figuring in Los Angeles, the crocheted objects knitted by these same researchers are physical models, not only of comsets and hyperbolic geometry, but also of natural shapes in the universe. It is also suggested by the group of scientists who crochet these shapes that the various curves and involutions may represent lines of development of different physical or conceptual development. The words at the bottom are instructions on how to do this for some of you who want to take up the challenge. While we're limited in our ability to understand much beyond two dimensions, particularly in our methods of assessment, statistics, and research design, we operate in the real world in at least as many dimensions as we have senses, then some, from our personal experiences, ethnic backgrounds, family histories, school experiences, habits of thinking, and belief systems. Thus, each one of the convolutions and involutions pictured could be seen as representing one facet of learning, which is distinct in some ways, but ultimately connected to the whole system. It may very well be that the above shapes are also an accurate image of what children go through in learning a complex skill, such as learning to read or write. Suppose we hypothesize that each curvature in the hyperbolic plane pictured in a moment represents a child's growing ability to understand and eventually control the multiple axis of the task we call learning to write. At any one time, these contours and cleavages may appear to operate in isolation, but as can be seen, they are nonetheless connected to one another in a complex but unitary shape, as Vygotsky observed nearly 100 years ago. In contrast to retrospective theories of development, prospective theories, such as represented by dynamic skill theory, indeterministic constraints modeling, probabilistic epigenesis, and Bronfenbrenner's biological theory of human development, are theoretical approaches in child and developmental psychology underscoring the normal processes of learning as being, among other things, characterized by spurts, plateaus, and drops rather than gradual growth, exhibiting equifinality, converging on the same end state from different beginnings, or multifinality, divergent outcomes from similar beginnings, and following an epigenemic course of development. In other words, the growth of trajectory is highly susceptible to what Gilbert Gottlieb has termed non-obvious experiential contingencies as much as planned experiences such as instruction. Further, prospective theories in developmental science suggest certain operative developmental principles which govern the progress of development in any area. Some of these include the following. A lower level ability is only solidified by operating at a higher level. In other words, mastery is only achieved by experimenting with higher level learning, not by repeating the lower level skill over and over and over again. Therefore, restricting anyone's learning to just the task at hand hampers the developmental process. Automaticity will not develop until a possibility exists to practice any skill at multiple levels of difficulty. Experimenting initially with a higher level of functioning usually results in the learner reverting to using lower level processes. However, rather than regressions, this utilization of earlier or familiar strategies has been denoted by Nira Grinnell as backward transitions that are iterative processes solidifying what has been learned so that advancement can become more rapid. And learners at any time are operating on multiple levels simultaneously. In other words, the development of competence or skill in any activity means that the learner brings a range of skill levels to the task at hand and uses them according to the levels of difficulty perceived to be inherent in the task to be accomplished. So let's return to Andres' writing sample from the standpoint of both retrospective and prospective models. First of all, in the retrospective model briefly discussed, only the name, the first of 11 tasks, can be used. Data from the other 10 tasks must be discarded. This is a tremendous waste of information. Secondly, since only the figural aspects of the name are scored in traditional assessments, Andres' name, although he demonstrates phonemic awareness of the individual letters, is no more useful in the model than any of the other four names written by children who did not attribute any sound values to the symbols. Thus, not only is data lost in a retrospective view, but the conceptual complexity of the data itself is reduced to and conflated with that of the description of the visual aspects alone. In child psychology, there's been a shift from a Cartesian-framed analysis of behavior to what Overton and Molinar have described as process-relational and relational-developmental systems paradigm. The advantage of using a relational-developmental systems orientation in discussing Andres' performance are that all the data can be used, and that the conceptual range that Andres demonstrates, from phonemic awareness of the letters in his name to the use of one symbol per syllable or one symbol per clause, to the iconic representation of the word also in his parents' names, can be interpreted according to overlapping waves theory, as well as the following principle of developmental theory that within child variation tends to be greatest during periods of rapid learning, though substantial variability is present in relatively stable periods as well. For Andres, then, the conceptual range within which he operated at this time may well have presaged a more rapid learning toward a conventional understanding of the uses of written language than perhaps the other children whose writing of the 11 tasks, conceptually at least, were more uniform. An oft-quoted passage of Vygotsky's from the prehistory of written language related to the teaching of reading to children, he writes, "If we should summarize the practical requirements and express them in a single position, then we could say that consideration of the problem leads us to the requirement to teach the child written language and not writing the alphabet. Or in the cases of scripts, which index other listing units, not to focus so much on those forms either, but as David Olson has suggested, teaching children about what it means to take meaning from script or bring meaning to it, teaching them the larger purposes of being literate in any society." Vygotsky suggests that we start this process in preschool. Developmentally speaking, my contention is that retrospective models of early literacy, such as simple models of reading, expect us rather to demand a slavish focus on the alphabet and figural convention. However, most prospective modeling and current microgenetic developmental theory urges us to do the opposite, as did Vygotsky, Piaget, and other developmental theorists. In other words, embrace the complexity of the developmental processes, as Vygotsky further argued, and bring the child to an internal understanding of writing in whatever language that may be. Vygotsky managed to write some 200 works, some of them full-length books, in the last 10 years before his death in 1934. And notably, he quotes poets and novelists such as Pushkin, Tolstoy, Pasternak, and Mandelstam as often as academics in his oeuvre, casting an extraordinarily wide intellectual and interdisciplinary net in developing his cultural historical approach. Thus, I want to end this address with a poem by Fyodor Ivanovich Tutchev, lines of which, according to a childhood friend, Vygotsky often quoted throughout his youth. For me, the poem expresses some deep themes in Vygotsky's work, which were not dimmed even in the face of his lifelong battle with tuberculosis, to which he succumbed at age 37. They are themes of hope, themes of wonder, and the embracing of the marvelous complexity of what it means to be human. we still believe in miracles. For all the lessons and the truths that life has taught us, we know there is beauty that won't pall and strength that cannot be exhausted, that flowers of a loveliness unearthly to earthly withering will not succumb, and dewdrops falling on them in the morning will not be dried up by the midday sun. It is a faith that won't deceive you if you live by it alone from first to last. Not everything that flowered once must wilt. Not everything that was must pass. Thank you.